Hello and welcome to worship with Cathcart Trinity Church. May God bless you today as you draw into his presence, as you draw close to him to bring yourself just as you are, but also to bring him the glory, honour and praise. God is our help and our refuge. God is the one who, even in the most helpless of situations, is the help that we need. The one who is our hope, our Lord, and our God. The God who has brought us into his presence, has showered us with his amazing grace, and has invited us to find freedom in him. Let's come and sing that glorious song. We're singing it today with the Praise Gathering Choir, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone.
Amazing grace. Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins, heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Father, we come to you today and we marvel at those words. We marvel at who you are, and we are amazed and grateful for what you've done. We thank you that you are a holy God, enthroned on high, a God who transcends all our thoughts and is worthy of all our praise. You have established your throne in heaven and you rule over all, and we worship you today in awe, in humility, and in thanksgiving. We read your word, but so often we fail to grasp the enormity of who you are and of what you've done. We are so conscious of our weak and faltering faith, of our doubts, and of our many failures. But Lord, you know all our thoughts. You know our every anxious thought. You know our selfish ones. You know the ones that make us happy. You know the deep desires of our hearts, and you know the things of which we're ashamed. Lord, you know all about us, and yet we read in your word that you have laid your hand upon us. You know everything there is to know about us, and yet your love is from everlasting to everlasting. Your love and forgiveness given freely. When we feel our faith might fail, you hold us fast. When we feel battered and unworthy, you still come and calm the storms in our lives. Lift us from whatever is our pit. Put our feet back on the rock. Steady us and put a new song in our mouth, a song of praise to you. So as we pray today, Lord, give us a greater understanding. Expand our focus, increase our love, and make our hearts break for what breaks yours. We all know how much is broken in our world today, and we pray for healing. We pray for countries like Yemen, the Democratic Republic of Congo, and Syria, countries in crisis or in ruin, where internal conflict, violence, hunger, and disease were already part of everyday life, and then came coronavirus. We think of refugee camps, of the upheaval people have known, of the emotional wreckage and heartache there, and then came coronavirus. Father, we pray and thank you for the international appeal. We pray that funds will be generously given and well used with wisdom and integrity. We pray for agencies working with very little infrastructure, that their help will reach the desperate and bring much needed resource, hope, and comfort. We pray, Father, for our own country in so much need. We pray for our politicians, national and local, that their decision making will be wise. As we move forward out of lockdown, Lord, we pray, so conscious of the huge damage caused by this virus. We pray for all who mourn, for those who have lost loved ones and not been able to say a proper goodbye. Comfort and sustain them, Lord. There have been so many other losses too, and Father, we pray for those who mourn the loss of their livelihood, their financial stability, and for those in business who have had to make heartbreaking decisions. We pray for those who have lost their confidence through this time of isolation. And we pray for those who feel they've lost the happiness they once enjoyed in their family life, where tensions have mounted, tempers have frayed, and barriers have been erected. Lord, we pray for healing and for compassion there. Lord, we pray for young people who've lost their connections with the activities they knew and with the friends they had. We thank you for Cara and her team for the Sunday Club and Pathfinders teams, for all their hard work, inspiration and enthusiasm in keeping connected with our young people. We give thanks for our Wonder Zone Holiday Club and pray for your protection on all that happens digitally with our young people. And Lord, we pray for the church as we rebuild too. We pray that you will keep us unified, that you will keep our focus on you. We ask for wisdom and strength, that our decisions will be wise and honouring to you. We thank you for what we have learned over recent weeks about prayer, about your desire to equip us for what is ahead. O church, arise and put your armour on. Hear the call of Christ our captain. For now the weak can say that they are strong in the strength that God has given. Lord, hear us as we pray for your strength to renew us, your love to restore us, and your Holy Spirit to fill us and lead us on. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
In our church news this week, there are three things I would love to share with you. First of all, many of you will be aware that we're doing a survey at the moment to think about how we might reopen the building. If you're interested in participating in that, whether you are a member of Cathcart Trinity who's been to the building in the past, or you've been worshipping with us online or whatever else, we would love to hear from you. The details will hopefully appear somewhere below this video. The other thing I would want to remind you is that while our buildings are closed, that we are still opening our church gardens for prayer. Feel free to go by at any point that you would like. On Sunday afternoons, there will be some folk around as stewards to help facilitate you between 1 and 3. So if you would like ever to go along and have someone to pray with you at an appropriate distance, that will be a possibility. Secondly, I'm delighted to say that next week we're hoping to hear from Donald MacLeod as he shares with us a little about the work that is going on with the City Mission. Finally, next Sunday evening, we're hoping to have another gathering for communion. This is going to take place on Zoom, and if you require details for that, please do get in touch with us. Over the course of lockdown, there have been a number of occasions where I've quoted Psalm 137 and asked its question, how shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? Now, I thought to myself it was about time that we actually turned to Psalm 137 itself to see how it would answer that question, how will we sing the Lord's song? So with that in mind, let's first pray and then come to God's word. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we praise and thank you for this word. We thank you for the way that your people of old wrestled with how they were to praise you and worship you in a context that was so different, so alien to what they were used to. We thank you for the way that their words can teach us today. So we would ask that you would open our eyes, open our ears, help us to see you, to worship you, and to honour you. Pray this all in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Psalm 137, reading the whole chapter. We read there. By the rivers of Babylon we sat and wept when we remembered Zion. There in the poplars we hung our harps, for there our captors asked us for songs. Our tormentors demanded songs of joy. They said, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How can we sing the songs of the Lord while in a foreign land? If I forget you, O Jerusalem, may my right hand forget its skill. May my tongue cling to the roof of my mouth if I do not remember you, if I do not consider Jerusalem my highest joy. Remember, O Lord, what the Edomites did on the day Jerusalem fell. Tear it down, they cried. Tear it down to its foundations. O daughter of Babylon, doomed to destruction, happy are those who repay you for what you have done to us, those who seize your infants and dash them against the rocks. Amen. What's your memory like? If I'm being honest about mine, it's not always the greatest. There are times that I can be halfway through one task, see another job that needs done, so go and do it, and then forget to return to the first thing I was doing. Alternatively, I can have put my phone sitting on charge and be walking around the rest of the house asking everyone, have you seen my phone? And it's sitting charging exactly as I needed it to be. I wonder in 5 years' time or 50 years' time, how we'll remember the year 2020. How we'll remember all that we are going through in relation to coronavirus and the changes that it's had on our lives. It's interesting, I've read a number of different articles in newspapers or blogs online that have talked about how they think this world will never go back to being the same as a result of all that we've gone through. And that our memories of it, how we explain it to our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, will help us interpret all that we have gone through. I begin with this question about memory, because the word remember is key to understanding Psalm 137. It's clear as we come to it, Psalm 137 is a psalm that is rooted in this place of heart. It's called one of the Psalms of Lament or Lamentations. This pouring out of a heart before God, expressing it how it truly is, and saying, Lord, this is awful. I don't know if you felt uncomfortable as the words were being read, as you thought about the position of these people far away from home, or perhaps it was the words at the end that you struggled with, the words looking for vengeance against the enemies, whether it was the Edomites or the Babylonians. May their children be destroyed. They're not easy words to hear, are they? But yet they're recorded here in our scriptures. Words that we are invited to explore and to understand. And as I said, I think it's through that key of the word remember that we begin to see exactly all that is going on. To see why God has recorded these words. To remind us in the first instance that he's a God that is big enough to take all of our pain and hurt. That we can come to God and express things just as they truly are. In fact, that's where we begin. Remembering what we've lost. That's one of the keys to singing God's song in a strange world. Remembering what we've lost. Look with me at the opening verses. By the rivers of Babylon we sat and wept when we remembered Zion. Remembering what they had lost. As we work through the psalm, we discover a whole number of different things they'd lost. First of all, they'd lost their home. Their city had been torn down. It would be like any picture that we see from war zones in our news now. Heartbreaking. Their children had been dashed to pieces. I can't even think about that. It is heartbreaking. They've been taken far away from home, which if we think about it on a theological basis, is also been taken far away from the land that God had promised them and the land that God had said he would make himself known in, where he would dwell with his people in terms of the temple. Although, of course, it's obviously far more complicated than that. For one thing, God cannot be contained in one building. That's what Solomon says. At the point he is opening up the temple and praying about it, he said, God, you cannot be contained here. Likewise, the exile, the people being taken away, is a lot more complicated than that. Because we realise in God's word that they are being exiled because of their unfaithfulness. But yet Psalm 137 is written by believers. Those who love God and have been caught up in this. Hurting because of what they've gone through. And then to add insult to injury. Their captors are coming along and saying, will you sing us a song? We'd love to hear a song of joy from Zion. Now, they're not being asked in a way that some people say, I want to hear about Jesus. Tell me about Jesus. They're being asked in a way that says, look, our culture has defeated your culture. But I want to hear about your culture in a quaint way. Sing us a song. We would like to hear it. We would like to see just how different it is. It's painful and it hurts. And these people are in that place of mourning. But I would want to suggest that this is where healing starts. Remembering what has been lost before God. What have you lost over the course of the last few months? Perhaps it's been moments with other people. I remember at the beginning of lockdown, sitting down and basically scoring out every appointment that I had in my diary for all of April. It was cathartic. On one level, no meetings. But on another level, it was heartbreaking to think about plans and goals that had just vanished. As a minister, it's been heartbreaking and hard at times to join families as they've been mourning the loss of a loved one. And they've been aware that they've not been able to say goodbye in the way that they had wanted. And beyond that, that friends and further relatives have struggled to be there at all. Healing begins with acknowledging before God all that has been lost. There are things that as we come to God to acknowledge that we're mourning the loss of them, that we realise actually we shouldn't be mourning the loss of that particular thing. That it's a silly thing, actually. I remember, and this is going to sound completely trite, but I'm just going to be honest with you. I remember going to a water park with my family and being upset that I wasn't able just to go on all the slides that I wanted on my own. How is that a bad thing to mourn about? Because actually, I am so, so blessed by being able to spend my time with my family. And actually, I discovered that in spending time in the water park with them, I was able to have more fun than I would have on my own. Sometimes we mourn the wrong things, but actually by bringing all of it before God, we are able to contextualise it all. We are able to acknowledge the hurt that we bear, and God is able to take it because he has strong arms. We remember what we have lost, but we also remember what cannot be taken away from us. Look at verse 4. How can we sing the songs of the Lord while in a foreign land? If I forget you, O Jerusalem, may my right hand forget its skill. May my tongue cling to the roof of my mouth if I do not remember you, if I do not consider Jerusalem my highest joy. At first glance, these verses appear a contradiction, don't they? That they're saying, look, I want to remember this city. And you're thinking, you're remembering a ruin. Remembering a place of pain and hurt. But they're remembering it in a way that actually helps us to understand what it means to worship God in a strange world. Because in this, they are actually remembering the promises of God that can never be taken away. Remembering the eternal things that we are called as Christians to cling to. If we go back to this idea about mourning, how does the Bible invite us to mourn? It says mourn, but mourn as those who have hope. For the people, as they were remembering this city, yes, they were remembering a place that had fallen and been destroyed. But beyond that, they were remembering, as I've alluded to already, the eternal promises of God. That God had said that Jerusalem was the place that he would make himself known. And that was of eternal significance. The people taken to Babylon were invited to come and just take in all of the culture around them. That's what's going on in Daniel chapter 1, where Daniel and his friends, known as Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego, are invited to become just like the Babylonians. But God's people have a different way. They know that they are not called to be just like everything else, but to remember the things of eternal significance, to fix their eyes on eternal and heavenly realities and not just in present situations. That is a massive help to those of us that are going through hard times at the moment through all that has happened with COVID-19. Because these verses remind us to remember that there are promises of God that can never ever be taken away from us. That while our worship may be different, while it might not always be easy, while we might personally be struggling with it at times, that God is still on the throne. That Jesus is still worthy to be praised. And that nothing this world can ever throw against him is able to change that. As Christians, we are invited to hold two things together honestly. First is an honest perspective about this world. To see it in its brokenness and incompleteness, but also to see what God has done, to see what God has planned, and to see how that can never fail. Are we able to do that? There are times that we get totally drawn into that first act of remembering, but God, through this psalm, invites us to see that actually there's processes going on. And while actually sometimes that process may involve a bit of a circle, coming back to a point that we've been at before, that there is a trajectory, that actually we are called to lift our eyes. In fact, there's a real irony in this psalm completely, because it is in a song that the psalmist is asking, how can I sing the Lord's song? He's discovered that how to sing the Lord's song is to sing a song. To bring it all to God and to contextualize it all by the fact that there are some things that can never be taken away. What God is doing will never fail, and we need to know that. We need to cling to that. Which brings us to the final act of remembering here in Psalm 137. And that's remembering to trust God for the final victory. We're back to the hard words, the words at the end of the psalm. Look what it says. Remember, O Lord, what the Edomites did on the day Jerusalem fell. It goes on, O daughter of Babylon, doomed to destruction, Happy are those who repay you for what you have done to us. In the context, what the people were asking here was for application of what was known as the lex talionis. That's to say, you may know it as an eye for an eye or a tooth for a tooth. They're wanting payment for what happened to them. They'd had their city pulled down. They'd had their infants killed. So they're looking for the same to happen. But there's more going on than that. We see that in the words that say, "Remember, O Lord." They're not going to seek out these activities themselves, but they're laying the destiny of these people before God. And that is helpful for us too, that we are called to remember, to bring things to God and trust Him for the eternal significance of things. To trust that He will work all things out according to His plan. Because God is still at work, and nothing that can ever happen will ever stop God's plans from happening. If you think about how Jesus applied what was known as the lex talionis, He said, well, what should you do? Well, He said, actually, if someone slaps you in the cheek, you should turn the other cheek. That if someone asks for your coat, you should give him your jacket as well. Or if someone forces you to go 1 mile, you go for two. You go far, far beyond. Jesus, in fact, tells us to pray for our enemies. To pray, in fact, that they would come to know God. That is the context that we come in now. Realizing, as Revelation reveals to us, that there is a day where every tongue is going to confess Jesus is Lord. Some of us are going to do it in awe and wonder. Others are going to do it in a cry of anguish. None of us want that for anyone. But that is where the enemies of God find themselves. There is a day where all viruses will be destroyed, where all sin and suffering will be over because God has won the final victory. And that's what Psalm 137 reminds us of, that God wins. It says it here in words that make us uncomfortable, but does point to that great truth that Jesus is Lord. And one day, everyone will know that. The question for us now is that, are we trusting Him? Are we being honest with God about our situation? And are we clinging to the eternal realities that He has held out for us? Are we trusting in Him rather than in our own strength? And are we remembering all that He is able to do?
Jesus, Savior, have mercy. Lord, you are the King.
And let us pray. Lord God, we praise and thank you that you are big and strong enough to take all of our pain and hurt. That you're gentle, like a good shepherd, who lifts us up and comforts us according to your amazing love. We ask, Lord, that we would never hold back our cries of heart, but that we would bring you all that we are honestly before you. We ask, Lord, that you would help us to remember the realities of the world around us, to not close our eyes to the pain, the suffering, and the heart. But beyond that, you would help us to remember all that you are doing. Help us to see your eternal victory, and help us to trust you in it. We praise and thank you that you are working all things out according to the glorious purpose that you have. And we ask that you'd help us to join you in that. That you'd help us to sing whatever song you're calling us to sing in this time. But sing it with gusto and with joy and with trust before you, our eternal Father. And now we pray a blessing on each other, that wherever we are and whatever faces us today, tomorrow or beyond, that you would go before us and with us, and that you'd help us to be a blessing to others. Would God, would you bless us all now and forevermore. Amen.